the winner of the annual game between those two teams would take home the keg of nails. And there's a lot of, I guess, back and forth about how exactly this came to be a trophy. Initially, it was supposed to symbolize that the side that won was tough as nails, and then I guess the whole keg got broken during a celebration one year, so they've had to replace it a number of different times. The whole story, and neither side can agree about where the trophy came from. They can't agree about what the overall record in the series is, but all we know for sure is that Louisville owns the keg right now because they won the last game.
Talking to Mike Rutherford, the author of 100 Things Louisville Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die. So can you lay out for us the career of Johnny Unitas?
Johnny Unitas is one of the more fascinating careers of any, I guess, great NFL player of all time. And a lot of people consider Johnny Unitas to be the greatest quarterback in the history of football. But he came to Louisville at a time when Louisville was not known for football whatsoever. In fact, they weren't even playing at the highest level of the sport, what we would now call FBS. But Louisville, they had an administration at the time that thought there was too much money devoted to athletics. They thought that football was getting too much attention, even though the program was not a national power. So Johnny Unitas basically came to Louisville because he had no other options. He was going to go to the University of Pittsburgh, I believe, and ended up not being able to test in. Came to Louisville, and before his sophomore season, the administration at UofL decided they weren't going to offer scholarships for football anymore. It was part of the way that they were going to cut down. So here's Johnny Unitas, who establishes himself as this just tremendous talent and has nobody around him, basically. And I think he actually ended up saying he learned how to have a quick release, to throw the ball, because he had such little blocking. He knew if he didn't get rid of the ball right away, he was going to get sacked, and the play wasn't going to go down at all. So he actually had to play both ways at Louisville. He played safety, he played quarterback, and his teams at UofL were really bad. And he kind of, because of that, was an unknown commodity coming out of college. Didn't make it in the NFL right away. Ended up having to spend a year playing semi-pro ball, and then actually for a brief period gave up football entirely and started working in business, and then got a last-second shot with the Baltimore Colts. Ended up actually getting the starting job in the NFL the same way that he got the starting job at Louisville, which was having a guy in front of him get injured, and the rest in both those cases was history. He never gave up the starting job. So a real fascinating career. Not a story that could happen in today's society at all.
Wow. Okay. Now, I just wanted to a quick background. I'm really an advocate of college basketball. I really love watching it. I think it's sometimes more competitive than the NBA. But in this particular instance, I remember seeing this live and I got sick to my stomach.
Same here, Eric.
What can you tell us about Kevin Ware's injury? And gruesome, just to keep it plain and simple.
Yeah, I mean, that was another one. I was actually in the building for that. And it's one of those things, I mean, your mind is never prepared to see something like that. I mean, you've never seen an exposed bone in a leg or his leg going the direction it was. So I think everybody who was there at the Lucas Oil Stadium in Indianapolis that afternoon back in 2013, that was something they'll never forget. People who were watching it live on television, they'll definitely never forget it. But it ended up becoming, Kevin Ware's just gruesome leg injury ended up becoming kind of the focal point of that Louisville run to the national championship. I mean, that week, he was on Letterman doing the Top 10 Countdown. He was on all these different national shows. He got invited to, the White House to go to dinner there with a lot of celebrities. It became just this larger-than-life story, and it was interesting because the forgotten aspect of Kevin Ware's injury is that he was actually playing his best basketball to date before he got hurt. And Louisville won that game in the Elite Eight against Duke where Ware got injured, so they had to go to the Final Four, and while everybody's looking at Kevin Ware as this human interest story, Louisville's looking at it as, we just lost our best reserve guard. We're trying to win a national championship. How does this all play out? And in the end, because Ware was hurt, they had to play a walk-on named Tim Henderson, who in Louisville's Final Four game against Wichita State came in, hit a pair of huge three-pointers that really catapulted them to victory. So it was all these just storylines building on top of one another that made it such a really just fascinating run to the national title for Louisville in 2013. And it kind of started with that really, really horrible injury from Kevin Ware.
No question about that. Talking to Mike Rutherford, the author of 100 Things Louisville Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die. So would you be able to describe to us the career of Wes Unseld?
Yeah, I think Wes Unseld, look, there was a poll here in town actually a couple of days ago that ran in the local newspaper, the Courier-Journal. channel asking, you know, everybody knows Muhammad Ali is from Louisville and was the greatest athlete from these parts, but who is the second best athlete with Louisville ties of all time? And Wes Unseld actually came in second in that poll. He is a, you know, one of the
over Unitas
around here. He was over Unitas, yeah. So
wow.
Somewhat surprisingly to me, Unitas was down there a little bit. He was 6 or 7.
Wow.
Yeah, Wesley Unseld around here. I think maybe because Wes grew up in this area, maybe he holds a spot near and dear to the hearts of Louisvillians. But Wes Unseld, it was interesting. I said in that story, he didn't start playing basketball until a late age. It was actually a teacher in his grade school who came up to him and was like, "You're a big guy. Why don't you go over there and play in the basketball game that the other kids are playing in?" He would rather have just sat in the shade and hung out by himself. He was a very shy kid. Started playing basketball there, went to Seneca High School here in Louisville, and became a national All-American, won a couple of state championships, decided to stay home and go to Louisville, and became arguably the best or second best player the university has ever known. And still to this day, he is only one of two players in NBA history to win Rookie of the Year and Most Valuable Player in the same season. He started off his NBA career with a bang, ended up having a terrific pro career. So he's maybe because he was born and bred in this area, maybe a little bit closer to the hearts of Louisvillians than some other people who just played at U of L.
Was an excellent defender, Wes Unseld. That's the one thing I remember about him.
And
no question.
And what can you tell us about the Governor's Cup?
The Governor's Cup is it's the trophy that Louisville and Kentucky play for in football every year. They actually just had the game a couple of weeks ago. It was in Lexington this year, and Louisville won. But Louisville and Kentucky, they didn't play football, which would surprise a lot of people who maybe don't follow the rivalry all that closely. Between 1924 and 1994, there were no games between Louisville and Kentucky in football. And I think Kentucky, for a long period of time, playing in the SEC, they felt like they were bigger and badder than Louisville. They felt like they had nothing to gain from playing quote-unquote little brother in their own state. And so the game just didn't happen. Then, because the basketball rivalry had become such a success since the 1980s when they started playing on an annual basis, government got involved and said, "Hey, you guys need to go ahead and play this game in football." And so in 1994, they decided they needed a name for the whole thing. Because the governor had gotten involved in the whole process, they went ahead and called it the Battle for the Governor's Cup. Kroger, the local business here, has put up some money to create this cup, which actually is ridiculously heavy. For anybody who's ever seen it or been around the trophy, it is far too heavy for a college football trophy to be, but yet somehow the players can hoist it up every year in celebration. But that has become the rivalry between U of L and UK in football, which has been going on since 94. And I think Louisville, in this new modern era of the series, they lead it 15-9, I believe. So they've been pretty successful since they started playing again.
Well, the Army-Navy trophy is pretty heavy, so they expect these guys to be like Atlas, lifting the world on their shoulders. Talking to Mike.
Yeah, you just played four quarters. You deserve to be relaxing, not hoisting 30 pounds of trophy over your head.
Yeah, exactly.
They bench enough. They can do it.
Talking to Mike Rutherford, the author of 100 Things Louisville Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die. And Mike, I'll get you out on this. What are your thoughts on the Louisville Adidas scandal?
Yeah, I mean, if you've noticed by looking at the cover of the book there, Rick Pitino actually wrote the foreword. The book was published on October 15th. Rick Pitino was officially fired at U of L on October 16th. So, yeah, timing's always been my thing. That was the perfect timing for the book to come out. The scandal has been something that Louisville fans have been familiar with now for, I guess, 3 years since the last scandal broke. This one a little bit different, obviously, because it involves multiple teams. It's not just Louisville, even though Louisville has been the focus because it resulted in Pitino being fired and Athletic Director Tom Jurich being fired. But this is a college basketball-wide thing. Louisville's role in the whole thing, obviously, it seems like they got in at the 11th hour, which is just their luck. The FBI had been conducting this probe into college basketball for 3 years, and at the last second, a Louisville assistant decided they're going to try and pay this recruit $100,000 with the help of Adidas. They got caught. It's evolved and it snowballed into this just gigantic thing where all these people have been fired, and it's forced UofL to take an internal look at a number of different things, including, you know, its arena funding, its relationship with the UofL Foundation, which was a fundraising organization, and just all this different stuff. And it's still being sorted out right now. I think people aren't really familiar or aware of how the NCAA is going to get involved in all this eventually, because Louisville already is on probation from its last scandal. So I think it's definitely affected Louisville basketball fandom. The attendance is down at games this year. People are having a harder time getting invested just because they're not sure exactly when this black cloud hanging over the program is going to go away, and when it does, what shape the program is going to be in. So it's certainly been a dark time to be a Louisville fan. Hopefully this book can serve as a reminder of some better times for people.
All right, Mike. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, guys.
All right. That was Mike Rutherford. His book is 100 Things Louisville Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die. Let's take a quick break, but don't go anywhere, because there's more of Beyond the Game coming up next on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
They'll challenge your authority. They'll try to break your will. They'll push you to the edge of your sanity. Because that's what kids do. But this car is your territory, not theirs. Defend it. Who makes the payments? Who cleans it? Who drives it? You do. That's who. And in here, your word is law. So when you say you won't move until everyone's buckled up, you won't budge an inch. Until you hear that click. Never give up until they buckle up. A message from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council. For more information, visit safercar.gov/kidsbuckleup.
Yo, what happened to your hair?
You have to experience what I just experienced.
What'd you do? Stick your finger in an electric outlet or something?
Close. I just listened to Electric Air.
Electric Air?
Electric Air.
Can everyone stop repeating Electric Air and tell me what Electric Air is?
Electric Air will get your heart racing, neurons sparking, and lips smiling. Join me, Tova, as I shock your ears with EDM's greatest hits. 5 out of 5 doctors agree 1 hour of Electric Air every week is just what you need to increase your energy and leave you feeling stimulated. Side effects may include uncontrollable mood swings, shuffling, and in some extreme cases, headbanging.
Too much headbanging, huh?
Dude, those side effects are serious. Seriously amazing.
So join me every Wednesday night at 8 for Electric Air on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
My name is Jacob Valk.
My name is
Jacob Valk.
My name is
so Marshall Mathers here on Beyond the Game.
Hey, he's got Walk on Water.
Jacob Valk.
He's got a new album coming out.
Jacob, whoa, don't say that.
That's
Eric.
A classic. Are you serious?
Walk on Water? I don't know. It ends with.
Oh, I thought you were talking about My Name Is.
No. I like this song.
It ends with Stamp.
Right.
It ends with Eminem talking about how he sang Stand, which is one of my favorite songs of his.
And it's going to turn into another song and stuff. I don't know. Just to me, Walk on Water with Eminem, Beyonce, just ended
underwhelming.
Weird.
It has no replay value. That's the problem. It's a good song, but real quick, the album's coming out Friday. Are we excited for this or not?
I am.
I'm excited for it. I can't help it.
I'm more of a classic rock person. Okay. I'm not really into rap, but good for you guys.
No, I like Eminem. I'm not a big rap guy, but I do like Eminem.
I like Eminem too. I like a couple of songs.
You are listening to Beyond the Game on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm Jacob Valk. You can follow me on Twitter at RealJacobValk. Sitting across from me, Eric Fischetti, who you can follow on Twitter at Sergeant Fish, and Joe Ardita, who you can follow on Twitter at JoeCoolNY. Number to call if you have something on your mind, or to win a 4-pack of tickets to the Long Island Nets Canton Charge game on December 23rd at 7 p.m. is 516-572-7440. While I've got your attention, I gotta tell you about a great show that we have on this station called Motormouth Radio. It's on Sundays at noon. Join the Motormouths, my pal Ray Guarino and Joe D, as they feature information, guest interviews, tech tips, and your calling questions on all topics relating to automobiles. Let's get to football
On Sunday, the Jets got shut out by the Broncos by a score of 23-0. Joe, what were your thoughts on that horror show in Denver?
I don't really have, like, any thoughts, honestly. I mean,
it's just move on to the next one?
I mean, I'll give some input, but I'm not going to go into, like, analyzing it. I mean, the fact that the Jets barely managed to scrape up 100 scrimmage yards. Like, I understand it's the no-fly zone. You know, they have a very good defense and whatnot. But
it's inexcusable. I don't care what it is. You got to put up some kind of an effort, and the Jets played like garbage.
They just rolled over and took a nap, and the offense looked, you know, completely incompetent. I mean, I turned it off, like, you know,